This is an auto-narrated audiobook generated by Google. Book: The Reformation in Poland, Some Social and Economic Aspects, by Paul Fox. Preface. In the foreword to his book on the Reformation in Germany, Professor Henry C. Vedder makes this statement: "The great religious struggle of the 16th century was only a phase of the social revolution then going on in Europe and affecting a transformation of all its institutions. Momentous economic changes were the underlying cause of political and religious movements. The external events of the Reformation have been told before with substantial accuracy. What is now needed is illumination of the facts by the light of this new knowledge." The present study on the Reformation in Poland attempts to gather together material of social and economic nature and to point out that the underlying causes of the rise and spread of the Reformation in Poland were chiefly social and economic, rather than religious, or even purely political. Viewed in this light, the rapid rise and the phenomenal growth of the Polish Reformation, as well as its almost complete collapse in the course of the following century, become quite intelligible. Had the movement had its roots in deep religious convictions, it would have survived the changes in social institutions. But, having been inspired and stimulated in its early development by economic motives, it lost its dynamic force with changed economic conditions by the end of the 16th century. Owing to the fact that the writer has had access to only a part of the great abundance of source material bearing on this subject, the study does not pretend to be exhaustive. However, it has the merit of being the first attempt to portray the development of the Polish Reformation in the light of economic causes, and in the judgment of the writer, the conclusions here reached and the interpretation given the movement are essentially sound. In this place, the writer wishes to express his indebtedness to Dr. John M. Vincent, Professor of European History at Johns Hopkins University, for his encouragement in the prosecution of this study and for his valuable suggestions and criticisms, and to Miss Mary C. Stokes of the Historical Department in the University for her careful reading of the manuscript before it's going to press. End of preface. Chapter 1: Development of the Reformation in Poland. The background of the Polish Reformation. The Reformation found in Poland a fertile soil and a congenial atmosphere for its spread and growth. To begin with, the attitude of the Polish princes was one of independence. They had, from early times, carefully guarded and vigorously defended their royal rights and prerogatives against the Church's pretensions and efforts at usurpation of power. When, for instance, Stanislaus Szczepanowski, Bishop of Krakow, encouraged by Gregory VII's triumph over Henry IV, attempted to make Gregory's policy prevail in Poland by placing himself at the head of the disaffected powerful Polish aristocracy, to whom a strong executive power was distasteful, and who desired to dethrone the reigning king and to enthrone his weak subservient brother, Boleslaus the Bold, 1058-1080, did not hesitate to put the rebellious bishop promptly to death. When Archbishop Henry Keitlitz, under the influence of Innocent III, 1198-1216, determined to introduce the Gregorian reforms into Poland at any cost, Vladislaus, surnamed Langshanks, 1202-1206, resolutely opposed the move even at the cost of his throne. Again, when the Polish clergy opposed a change in the payments of tithes, from payments in kind to payments in money, Boleslaus the Bald of Silesia, ordered the imprisonment of Thomas, Bishop of Breslau, together with one of his canons, had them put in stocks, and though the Archbishop of Niesen excommunicated Boleslaus, and the Pope ordered the Archbishops of Niesen and Magdeburg to proclaim a crusade against him, Boleslaus did not yield until Thomas made peace with the prince by paying a fine of 2,000 silver marks and by agreeing to payments of tithes in money. And when later the Bishop of Breslau opposed the levying of a tax on the clergy for the benefit of the prince's treasury, Boleslaus' son, Henry, now Prince of Silesia, exiled the recalcitrant bishop. Though excommunicated for this act by the Archbishop of Niesen, he did not permit the bishop's return until after 5 years of exile, the bishop finally yielding and submitting to the tax. Besides these instances, there were others. Leszek the Black, 1279-1288, was at odds with the Bishop of Krakow, Paul of Pszeminkow. The bishop, an implacable enemy of the king, conspired against the king, incited the aristocracy against him, and caused even an invasion of Little Poland by the Lithuanians and the Jadzwings. The king dispersed the invaders, confiscated the bishop's property, and imprisoned him in the castle of Sieradz, putting him in stocks. It was only when the pope threatened Leszek with excommunication that the king liberated the imprisoned bishop. In the 14th century, Casimir the Great, 1333-1370, imposed a tax on episcopal property. The Polish high clergy resented that and excommunicated the king. Casimir ordered the priest, who brought the bull of excommunication to him, to be seized and drowned in the Vistula River. And since Casimir was a powerful and popular ruler, the clergy took due warning and desisted from further provocative steps. Moreover, it is worthy of note that while in Germany, the right of investiture was surrendered as early as 1122 by the Concordat of Worms, in Poland, the princes defended and retained the right as late as 1206. And in the second half of the 15th century, taking advantage of the existing schism in the church at that time, they again regained it and made it a permanent and indisputable prerogative of the Polish crown. Even such a loyal son of the church as Sigismund the Old, 1506-1548, did not allow the Pope to interfere with his right in this particular. When at the beginning of Sigismund's reign, the Pope deliberately nominated a candidate for the bishopric of Plock, the king refused to accept the papal nominee, stating that he would never consent to such violation of the country's laws by allowing anyone else to nominate the kingdom's senators. Again, when later in Sigismund's reign, Pope Hadrian VI was delaying his approval of the king's nomination of Leszczynski to the bishopric of Posen, Sigismund notified the Vatican that the Pope's refusal to comply with his just wishes might result in unpleasant consequences to the Holy See, whereupon the Vatican at once approved Leszczynski's nomination to the bishopric of Posen. An equal measure of independence characterized the Polish high clergy in respect to its relation to the Vatican. Prince Vladislaus II, 1138-1146, striving to establish a strong, unified, and centralized government in defiance of the provisions of his father's will, which divided the kingdom among four of his sons, aroused the opposition of the aristocracy and of the clergy, to whom a strong centralized government was very unpalatable. James of Zanin, Archbishop of Niesen, as leader of the opposition, excommunicated the stubborn, ambitious prince and forced him to abdicate. Vladislaus appealed his case to Conrad III, Emperor of Germany, and to the Pope. Both of them responded, the emperor with a military expedition and the pope with a legate. When on arrival in Poland, the pope's legate, Cardinal Guido, was unable to secure a return of the throne to Vladislaus, he excommunicated the opponents and placed the country under an interdict. The Polish bishops, however, paid no attention to the legate's excommunication and interdict, and Vladislaus, though supported by the pope, had to remain in exile until his death in 1159. Vladislaus, surnamed Langshanks, 1202-1206, in his opposition to the Gregorian reforms, upon which Pope Innocent III insisted, had the support of many high church dignitaries among the Polish clergy. Philip, Bishop of Posen, for instance, refused to promulgate in his diocese the papal interdict, under which Archbishop Keitlitz was instructed to place the country. To what extent the Polish clergy disregarded papal decrees may be seen from the fact that though Pope Gregory VII, 1073-1085, decreed a general enforcement of celibacy among the Roman clergy, marriage among the clergy of Poland, according to the historian De Lugos, was still generally common as late as the close of the 12th and the first quarter of the 13th century. It is quite instructive to note that even such high church dignitaries as John Laski and James Ukanski, both archbishops and primates of Poland, the first from 1510 to 1531 and the second from 1562 to 1578, were very unfavorably disposed toward the Vatican. As bishop and secretary of state, Laski declined to support the Pope's project of forming a league against the Turks. As Archbishop of Niezen and Primate of Poland, he worked for the emancipation of his archbishopric from Rome to such an extent as to alarm not only his enemies, but even his friends and the king himself. Ukanski's orthodoxy and loyalty to Rome had been long under suspicion at the Vatican, so much so that when Sigismund Augustus, 1548-1572, appointed him to the bishopric of Chelm, the pope did not ratify the appointment for several years, and when the king promoted Ukanski to the bishopric of Kujawia, the pope refused to sanction the promotion altogether. This served only to estrange Ukanski from the Vatican still more, and led him, especially on his elevation to the Archbishopric of Niezen, to entertain plans and to advocate the advisability of calling a national synod and of withdrawing the Church of Poland from the jurisdiction of Rome. When the papal legate, Commendoni, dreading such a consequence, urged the Vatican to forbid, contrary to the decisions of the Council of Trent, the holding of provincial synods in Poland for fear that one of them might at any time be turned into a national synod, the Polish bishops rose in protest against it in the Senate of the Diet, going even so far as to declare that the king and not the pope was their overlord and judge. The people, too, manifested the same spirit of independence in their attitude toward the church, whenever occasion demanded. In the 11th century, they arose in rebellion against the oppression of both state and church, particularly the church, owing to the foreign character of its clergy and their burdensome exactions. They demolished churches and monasteries, drove out the priests and the monks, and reverted to paganism. In the struggles of the state with the papacy for supremacy, the people generally supported the state. This explains the boldness and self-confidence of the Polish rulers, with which they successfully opposed the pretensions of the papacy, much longer than the German emperors. The papal anathema, hurled against recalcitrant princes and shaking the very foundations of Western thrones, fell in Poland without causing much disturbance or harm. Another factor, which in a large measure prepared the soil for the spread of the Reformation in Poland, was humanism. The new turn in literature and philosophy reached Poland early in the 15th century and found many friends, both among the laity and among the clergy. One of the most distinguished Polish humanists was John Ostrorog, 1402-1501, a doctor of both laws from the University of Erfurt and a strong advocate of the supremacy of the state over the church. In his dissertation, Monumentum pro re publicae ordination congestum, Ostrorog wrote in 1473, "The Polish king recognizes nobody's supremacy save that of God. Instead of assuring the new pope of his obedience, he will sufficiently fulfill his duty if he congratulate him, and at the same time remind him that he should rule the church justly. It is below the dignity of the king to write to the pope with humility and humbleness. The clergy should help bear the burdens of the state as well as other citizens. There is no need of being indignant when the king orders the melting of church utensils for public needs. The church has gold not for the purpose of keeping it, but for the purpose of helping the needy. All payments for the benefit of the pope should be abolished. Poland needs all the funds she can spare for war with invaders and for the preservation of domestic order and peace. The proclamation of jubilee papal bulls, as well as fees for funerals, marriages, etc., should be prohibited. The king should nominate the bishops. In order to decrease the number of idlers, the establishment of monasteries in cities should be restricted, the admission for foreigners to them prohibited, and sermons in the German language diminished in number." Such were the predominant sentiments of the time, says Dr. Lewinsky Corwin, in true keeping with the teachings of humanism, which spread in Poland through constant contact with Germany and Italy, in the principles of which several generations preceding the Reformation had been reared, and in accordance with which they shaped their views and opinions. The condition of the Polish Church and the character of the Polish clergy in the 15th and 16th centuries, too, were favorable to the spread of Reformation ideas in Poland. Lorkowicz characterizes the Polish church and the Polish clergy of this period thus: "The church, which by its calling and its nature should be the guardian of the oppressed, the defender of the weak against the strong, the moral guide of men, and the regulator of social conditions, had allied itself with those social factors which sap the very lifeblood of society, offering it in exchange only a form without content, a body without a soul. It had become a ballast, not such as steadies the easy movement of a light vessel, but such as threatens the storm-tossed ship with certain destruction. The clergy, if it is fit to use such unpalatable comparison, was at this time like an old church beggar, who, having said the prayers that had been paid for, had nothing more pressing to do than to hurry and in a particular and characteristic manner waste the alms he had received. The Polish clergy led as dissolute a life as did the clergy elsewhere in Europe. The Polish bishops were far more interested in their incomes, their social standing, and in their political influence than in religion and morals. The indignation of the nobles, therefore, at the freedom the clergy enjoyed from taxation and other burdens was intense. They were strongly opposed to church tithes and to ecclesiastic jurisdiction, and resented papal interference in matters of state. Pre-Reformation reform movements. Into this receptive Polish soil, the seed of religious reform had been sown from time to time for nearly 400 years, and as it grew and developed, though greatly hindered from time to time, it helped to create an atmosphere favorable to the main religious reform movement of the 16th century. The followers of Peter Waldo, persecuted in Italy, sought safety in other countries. As early as 1176, some of them found refuge in Bohemia, and others settled in Poland, near Krakow. Here they spread their master's teachings, and found many adherents both among the Czechs and among the Poles. Polish chronicles record the names of a number of Waldensian Poles. In time, these Waldensians must have become sufficiently numerous and active, for Pope John XXII found it imperative to appoint in 1326 a special inquisitor for Poland in the person of Peter of Kolomea, a Dominican, and in 1330 the Inquisition discovered that there were many Poles and Czechs visiting the Waldensian churches in Italy and making liberal contributions to them. Wycliffe's influence reached Poland by way of Bohemia through the masters of the University of Prague, who at the Polish king's request became the reorganizers of the University of Krakow. Andrew Galka, a professor in the University of Krakow, an ardent admirer of Wycliffe and a diligent student of his works, wrote a poem in which he praised the English reformer and denounced the priests as servants of the German emperor and his Antichrist, who suppressed the truth and taught the common people falsehoods. For this poem, and for having Wycliffe's works in his possession, he was expelled from the university and imprisoned. He escaped, however, from his imprisonment, and sought the protection of Boleslaus of Silesia, whence he carried on an extensive correspondence, justifying his position and urging his readers to read Wycliffe's works. Owing to the existence of close political and intellectual relations between Bohemia and Poland in the 15th century, Hussitism found easy access to the latter country and attracted many followers and sympathizers from among the Poles. Its anti-German, anti-papal, and nationalistic character found a responsive chord in their hearts. Huss and his ideas met with great favor on the part of many of them. At the Council of Constance, the Polish lay representatives sided with the Bohemian delegation and loyally defended Huss and his cause to the last. A number of powerful Polish aristocratic families, like Spytek of Melston, Abraham of Zeebons, Dursla of Reitwin, and others, became ardent supporters and defenders of Hussitism. Abraham of Zeebons harbored and protected Hussite preachers in his possessions for years, in spite of the fact that he was excommunicated for this offense by the Bishop of Posen. Hussitism was spreading in Poland to such an extent as to cause alarm among the church authorities. The Archbishop of Niezen, Nicholas Tromba, called a synod to assemble at Kalisz, at which it was decided to apprehend suspected heretics and to deliver them into the hands of ecclesiastical tribunals. Cardinal Zbigniew Olesniki used his influence with the king and secured from him the Edict of Wieland, 1424. By this edict, the new teachings were declared to be deadly errors of heretics, contemptible to God, detrimental to the Christian faith, enervating to the body politic, inflammatory of perverse hearts, and should be repulsed and kept out of the country, if need be, by the sword. Heretics, protectors of heretics, and heretical suspects were to be regarded as traitors and were to be punished by death. Those coming from Bohemia and entering Poland were to be examined by inquisitors, and if suspected of heresy, they were to be detained. Polish subjects, whatever their class or condition, visiting or residing in Bohemia, were to return to their country by next Ascension Day, and if they failed to do so, they were to be regarded as heretics, subject to punishment as heretics. Obstinate heretics were to be punished by confiscation of property in favor of the crown treasury, and neither the offenders themselves nor their posterity were to be admitted to any public office or to any official honors. And Polish merchants were forbidden to export anything to the heretics of Bohemia. In spite of this drastic edict, intended to check the spread of Hussitism in Poland, the Bohemian Hussites sent some of their emissaries to Krakow in 1427 for the purpose of conducting religious discussions. The Polish historian De Lugos, who was Cardinal Olesnicki's secretary, reports that such a discussion, in which the Hussite representatives and the Roman Catholic doctors of the University of Krakow participated, was actually held in the city of Krakow in 1431, in the presence of the king, and characteristically adds that the heretics were vanquished, but would not admit it. On January 30, 1433, due again to Cardinal Olesnicki's influence, another royal edict was issued against the heretics. Its intention was to lend effectiveness to ecclesiastical excommunications by providing for seizures by the starostas of the property of excommunicated church offenders who had been under the ban of the church for more than a year without effort to have it lifted. It seems that even this measure did not materially help to keep the Hussite heresy in check. After the death of Vladislaus Jagiello in 1434, the Hussites were strong enough to offer some opposition to the regency of Cardinal Olesnicki, for he and his party entered into a pact of confederation at Kherson on April 25, 1438, for the purpose of acting together to subdue any possible political or religious disturbance. To counteract this, the opposition, headed by Spytek of Melston, the acknowledged leader of the Hussites, entered into a similar pact on the 3rd of May of the year following. This step on the part of the Hussites led to a clash between the two confederated parties, resulting in Spytek's death, confiscation of his property, and in the ruin of the Spytek family. That all these measures were ineffective to check the spread of Hussitism in Poland is further evident from the fact that Casimir Jagiello, 1447 to 1492, the king who restored to the Polish crown the right of investiture, lost to the Pope in 1206, issued in 1454 an order to the civil authorities in the dioceses of Niezen, Posen, Wrocław, and Plock, to the effect that they cooperate with the appointed inquisitors in running down heretics. It must not be supposed, however, that Casimir Jagiello was a zealous defender of the Roman Church and a determined opponent of Hussitism. In 1462, he entered into an alliance with the excommunicated Hussite king, George Podjebrad of Bohemia, and maintained the alliance in the face of strong inducements as well as threats from the Catholic party to break it. When the Pope, in his opposition to Podjebrad, had gone so far as to attempt a crusade against the Hussites in Poland, Casimir sternly prohibited the proclamation of it. In the western parts of Poland, the traces of Hussitism were so deep that as late as 1500, the nobility of Great Poland demanded the cup at communion. The work of the Hussites was reinforced by demands for reform, made by loyal sons of the Church of Rome, who had caught the spirit of Hussitism. Two men, both professors of theology at the University of Krakow, though at different times, Matthew of Krakow and James of Paradis, became especially conspicuous within the Polish Roman Catholic Church in the 15th century for their advocacy of reform. Matthew of Krakow was born in 1330 of a family of town clerks, Stadtschreiber. Having received his preparatory education in his hometown, he went to study theology at the University of Prague, where he took all the university degrees one after another, and finally in 1387 became professor of theology. In 1394, he went as professor of theology to the University of Heidelberg.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.